I feel so blessed to be here, and I feel so blessed to have received this rich, warm, and authentic welcome. I like real people. Yes. Amen. I'm a grown woman.
Amen.
And I don't spend a lot of time being phony. Completely and entirely grown. Anybody understand what I'm saying? And I love to hear young people who know who they are and whose they are. And have hearts that are full of hospitality. I love you like that too. Amen. And I feel you as my companions on the journey, part of my network, doing the work of justice in the earth. And I feel so blessed to be in this place that this preacher told me about when we were at Princeton together. And I said, tell me a little bit more about it, Bishop. And he told me, and he told me, and he told me. And it got more and more beautiful in my imagination. But it's even more incredible in my eyesight. I praise God for the new vision. Lord, I want to ask you. To also be in the presence, I don't know if Pastor Christine, did she have to go? Pastor Spivey, amen. God bless you, Pastor Christine. Pastor Christine and Pastor Mike Spivey from the Citadel of Hope Worship Center are also with us today, and I praise God for you. She's going to have to check out her service. She told me she was coming, and she did. And she brought Pastor Mike, and they are such a beautiful couple, doing such incredible work. We're dangerous in this room today. Amen. Tell somebody, we're all here. This is what the enemy said couldn't happen. We're all here. Thank God. I want to thank God, of course, for Pastor Vanessa. Pastor Vanessa Brown is the Episcopal assistant to her bishop. The eastern region of the United States, the northeastern region. And she is pastor, of course, of Rivers of Living Waters. Amen. Thank you. Sit down on your iPad and march on and have you reading the text. There was a Russian psychologist whose name was Ivan Petrovich Pavlov. Some of you all possibly have heard of Pavlov's theory. Those of you that have studied psychology, those of you that have had to go see a psychologist. Nothing wrong with it. Amen. Pavlov was a Russian psychologist known primarily for his work in what is called classical conditioning. The way by which people learn. In the 1800s, he discovered that behaviors could be triggered by signals. And let me explain a little bit. His work is classical in that it is the first systematic study of the way that human beings learn. You know your ABCs, but you probably have never questioned is how were you able to learn? How do we learn? Because in so many ways we are what we have learned. Stimulus is capable of enlisting a reaction. What does it mean? Pavlov used dogs in his experiments. You may have heard his name associated with Pavlov's dogs. He used dogs in his experiments. And it's very simple. This is what he did. He found that if you ring a bell that has nothing to do with food, but each time you ring the bell, you feed the dog. Eventually, the dog will associate the ringing of the bell with mealtime. Anybody want to go? Ding, ding, food. Okay. And the dog, over time, will begin to salivate. When the dog hears the bell ringing, the dog will, his mouth will water. And it's even more systemic than that. The dog's digestive system will begin to prepare to eat. His whole body will be engaged with getting ready to eat at the ringing of a bell if you associate the ringing of the bell with food. What you will then do is establish a pattern. And over time, a dog gets conditioned to it. Now, here's the other thing he learned in this experiment. If you ring the bell, and then you stop providing food, you will eventually break the relationship that the dog has between the bell ringing and food eating. Anybody understand what I'm saying? Then you can ring the bell all day. Ring, 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 and the dog will just look at you. However, the process of moving from being conditioned to be hungry at the ringing of the bell, and then hearing the bell and not being hungry anymore, takes the dog through all kinds of changes. Anybody understand what I'm saying? It's a rough trip. Okay? It's difficult for the dog. In fact, it was extremely difficult for the dog. And took the dog through seasons of being violent, angry, physically and emotionally destabilized. The stimulus was the bell. The response was the anticipation for food. It was beyond a mental and emotional response. It was visceral and physical. And so when it was taken from the dog had a visceral, physical, emotional reaction to it. I've raised dogs. I love dogs. And I know something about raising dogs in the city and raising dogs in the crate. Some of you all may know something about crate training the dogs. If you don't, you have a crate in the house and you don't want the dog to do things all over the house. You keep the dog confined until it's pee-pee and poo-poo time. Then you take the dog out to the designated location. And then when the dog is done with the pee-pee and poo-poo, you bring the dog back. Put the dog back in the crate. And let the dog Conditioning has taught us that if you open the door, when it is time to go for a walk, anybody hear me?
Yes.
In time, you can keep the door open, and the dog will stay in the crate until you come and say, come on, let's go walk. You don't even have to close the crate door, because the dog will condition himself to stay confined, even when the door is wide open for him to be free. In time, what will happen is he will be clear that that's his crate, and you don't even have to shut the door. Now, if you take the crate, the dog will go back to the place where the crate is supposed to be, and look for it, and will sit on the floor, and have dislocation, and frustration, and disassociation. What the heck is what the dog is saying? Are we doing? And where's the crate? What does this mean? We just went through our teeth. What the what? Because you've disturbed the order of my training. I've heard stories about people who have been in solitary confinement for many years. And when they are free, they choose to confine themselves in a small dark room and will sleep on a pallet on the floor because they've been conditioned for prison. Anybody understand that? Freedom has come, but their body hasn't gotten the message. Freedom has come, but their minds haven't gotten the message. Freedom has come, but their spirits have not gotten the message. A friend a few days ago related a story to me. He's an apostolic brother. How many folks from the apostolic Pentecostal church in this room? Where are you? Put your hand up. That's right. I see you. And how many Pentecostals are here? I see you. Don't come out. You'll appreciate this. He said he went to a musical service at an apostolic Pentecostal church. And there was a sister dressed in an outfit that had a very low-cut neckline. Walk with me. Such that the tattoo that was on her breast was in full view. She was high and lifted up. Anybody understand me? Then perhaps we would think properly. And her thigh tattoo was also exposed. Anybody walking with me? But what was so interesting is that she also wore a head cover. Anybody get what I'm saying? She had a head cover, a doily on her head. Do you understand what I'm saying? Thank you. she's unclear. She's sure that she can't be where she was.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But she's not sure where she's going.
Yeah, yeah.
She hears Jesus calling her name out of the grave. Daughter, just like he called Lazarus. Daughter, come forth. And I don't know if I can do this. I've never been resurrected from this before. Been in a legalistic grave too long. Sunlight of freedom is destabilizing me. So this reflection in Galatians 5 suggests that a systemic reality begs the question today. If we are freed from the bondage of legalism, why do we consistently return to it? When Jesus was crucified, he denied it. Fear made him do that. And then when Jesus was killed and buried, Peter went back fishing because he defaulted, come on now, to his dysfunction because he really didn't know how to process his freedom. Come on. He went back to what he knew because he had been conditioned to do that. And he could do that asleep. Sometimes when we don't know what to do, we will go back to our bondage, come on. Because freedom is too hard for us. Would you be offended if I were to say it's the unlearning that's hard. It just almost kills you because if he's a boy and he don't know how to do it. Pete went back to fishing because he didn't know what to do. If you take away from me the familiar, it's hard for me to have enough faith to believe that God will fill it with something else. I can't learn, I can't move on. This is the question. Why would we remain in a grave after resurrection has been given to us? Why would we stay in the law if we've been given grace as a gift? Yes. If the stone is rolled away and we've been given freedom, why are we holding it? I just have to. I can't just walk out. But you'll never know true freedom until you take the courage, listen to me, to follow the voice of God calling you.